Dr. Connie Webster, Associate Provost for Academic Programs and Professor in the Department of Nursing and Allied Health at the University of the District of Columbia, and your host for Health Matters. Our purpose is to assist you in managing your health care by providing you balanced information and resources to help you make knowledgeable choices about your health. The Cardiovascular and Endocrine Liaison Program serves as a liaison between the FDA and the cardiovascular and endocrine health professional and patient communities. The program encourages and supports our active participation in forming FDA regulatory policies that promote healthy dietary and nutrition practices and advances the safety and effectiveness of human medical products that treat diabetes, hypertension, heart disease, and obesity. Joining me to share more on this important topic is Dr. Helene Clayton Jeter, Director of the Cardiovascular and Endocrine Liaison Program in the FDA Commissioner's Office of Health and Constituent Affairs. In her role, she serves as a channel through which health professionals and patient issues and viewpoints can be brought to the attention of FDA medical and regulatory staff. Dr. Clayton Jeter serves as a subject matter expert in the areas of optometry, ophthalmology, cardiovascular disease, and diabetes. Dr. Helene Clayton Jeter, welcome to Health Matters. I'm glad that you took the time, and I know that you have a very, very big plate with just the kinds of things that you have to cover. Mm-hmm. And when I was reading through your bio, resume, your little bio, I found out that you are really an optometrist.
Yes.
By trade, or by training.
Yes.
So right away I became curious. Maybe we can start out by having you share with our viewers how you became interested in public service.
Well, that's interesting. It's been a long, circuitous route. It was not a straight linear line, you know, like a lot of people think, oh, you go to school, you do this. No, I practiced clinical optometry for 21 years in a lot of different practice modalities, from private practice to my last 7 years I worked for an HMO. But through my clinical experience, I always worked in my community. My kids' elementary school, I started different committees, health disparities, somewhat like cultural connections committees. I thought it was very important that everybody's voice would be heard. So mm-hmm. in my community, I started doing things like that. And then while I was at Kaiser Permanente, I had an opportunity to start a lot of committees. And there were committees that would bring the health providers together and talk about issues and how we could give better care. So even though I was a clinician, I always did advocacy work for my community mm-hmm. and for consumers. Mm-hmm. So moving over to the FDA, which seemed like not a real logical step for an optometrist, and you're right, because in my current office, I'm the first optometrist they've ever hired. But I think my medical background gave me the foundational information and the foundational skills that I could bring to the table. But it was really my community involvement and the different programs that I led in my community. One specifically was a public-private partnership where I was the co-chair and executive board director. So that we raised money for the working poor, children of the working poor. And these were kids that their parents worked 2 and 3 jobs, but they just did not have health insurance. Mm-hmm. So the success of those types of programs, volunteering and being a voice for the voiceless, mm-hmm. it started a long time ago.
I like that, a voice for the voiceless. And in healthcare, especially for us in nursing, advocacy is a big part of what we do. Mm-hmm. And I'd like to say that you're a perfect fit for Health Matters, because we are as well always trying to empower consumers of healthcare. Mm-hmm. Many of my viewers, I'm sure, have heard of the Food and Drug Administration, or FDA, mm-hmm. but I'm glad to have someone here who can really give us a good feel for what the FDA really is, Who are the people that they employ? What are their major goals and focus? So maybe you can share that information with the viewers and they can get a better feel for just exactly how you work there.
Okay, great. Well, the Food and Drug Administration, if you look at our mission, basically our mission is to ensure safety and effectiveness and security of human and animal, drug, and biological products. We regulate not only drugs, which most people are familiar with,
right,
but we also ensure the safety of cosmetics, radiating emitting products, you know, like your microwave, and we regulate tobacco products. That's our newest area. We're responsible for the oversight of more than $2 trillion in medical products, food, and tobacco, approximately 20% of the consumer spending. The FDA employs over 12,000 people, and most of those people work out in the field.
Mm-hmm.
I work on the main campus in Silver Spring on New Hampshire Avenue. That's our main campus, but we have field people all over the United States and in other countries. Right now, and I give you a little statistics, there are over 5,800 categories of medical devices.
Mm.
There are over 183,000 registered facilities. More than 50% of those facilities are abroad, so they're not even here in the United States.
Mm-hmm.
We regulate over 14,800 prescription drug products.
Right.
And then let's look at the regulated products in tobacco, the newest area. We're regulating over 4,800 products like cigarettes, smokeless tobacco, roll your own tobacco. And so we cover a lot of ground with what we regulate. I was talking about the field offices before, but we also have laboratory offices. And on our main campus, that's where you will find the commissioner of the FDA, and that role is similar to a CEO of a corporation. Also on that campus, you will find our centers. We have different centers, centers for drugs, center for devices, center for tobacco, center for foods, and that's all on the main campus on the FDA campus in Silver Spring, Maryland. What other information could I kind of give your viewers that I may not, that you think they will be interested as far as knowing more about the FDA?
I would particularly, I'm curious about, and I'm sure it may be curiosity for them as well. You mentioned field officers mm-hmm. and other people that help to support what you do mm-hmm. As a liaison. What are the usual disciplines or what are some of those professionals?
Okay, let's just talk about my office. My office, the Office of Health and Constituent Affairs, we have pharmacists,
yes.
nurses. We
yes.
have two nurses
yes.
In our office. We have public health, people that have masters in public health,
okay.
of course. And let me look at all the backgrounds in my office. We have pharmacists, of course, because most of the products that we regulate are drugs, so mm-hmm. we are very pharmacy heavy. And then you have an optometrist with me. We even have someone has a background in entomology in my office, you know, so don't even ask how that came about.
Okay.
But it's a variety of backgrounds, but mostly people are in, they have a medical, biology, even chemistry. I think at one time we had an engineer in our office. So we employ a lot of people from different disciplines, and you know we have an office of general counsel, so we employ lawyers.
Yeah.
We have office of surveillance and enforcement, and so we have people with a lot of different backgrounds that you probably wouldn't think of as careers
mm-hmm.
Within this agency.
You're absolutely correct, because even for me, mm-hmm. when I think about the Food and Drug Administration, mm-hmm. I'm usually thinking about foods and drugs.
Mm-hmm.
And you just brought in some aspects, microwaves, all of those other different things. I never even thought about that. Now, there have been times when I've heard people or heard an announcement to the effect that this is not regulated by the FDA, mm-hmm. and I would think that that's something that you just didn't look at. But now that we've talked about what you do, mm-hmm. what is it that you, as FDA, that you don't do?
Well, it's interesting that we're talking about this, because just today I met with an outside stakeholder and we approached this conversation because a lot of times people think that we perform clinical trials.
Okay.
We don't perform clinical trials. They're done by industry, manufacturers, or sponsors, as we call them. So we do not conduct clinical trials. Insurance. A lot of people think we regulate cost. And this is last presidential campaign. I heard someone erroneously mention, we're going to get the FDA to lower cost on drugs.
Yes.
That is not us.
Okay.
That's CMS. So
okay.
Cost is outside of our purview. We don't regulate, of course, illegal drugs or illegal use of drugs or abuse. And consumer products like toys, that's outside of our purview. Meat and poultry, which is kind of interesting, that's under the Department of Agriculture, but there are some exceptions. We do regulate game meats such as venison, ostrich, and snake. Don't ask me why we regulate those and not the others, but we do. And we don't regulate biological products intended for veterinary use, even though there are products for veterinary use, we do drugs, but not biological products. And of course, you can look at advertising.
Mm-hmm.
We don't regulate advertising unless it's for prescription drugs or medical devices and tobacco products. So, but most important, we do not regulate the practice of medicine. So your health professionals, they are regulated by their state boards and
right.
their national boards.
They're regulated.
We have nothing to do with that.
Right, right. Now, let's focus in a little bit on your office in particular.
Okay.
You are the director of a very important office, and it deals with some health diseases or chronic diseases or disparities that we frequently addressed here on Health Matters in terms of cardiology and your and some of the diseases that come under endocrine. And so your office that is called the
Office of Health and Constituent Affairs.
Right. And then in particular, what is the KELP for?
Oh, the Cardiovascular and Endocrine Liaison Program. That's
yes.
actually the program that I manage.
Yes.
Direct.
And I am particularly interested in the role. I mean, we talk about it as a disparate kind of entity occurring, particularly among our African-American communities.
Yes.
So help us to understand what role your office plays in getting consumers and healthcare in that liaison role. What role do you play?
So I guess it's kind of, I guess we should give a little organizational structure. At the FDA, there is the commissioner's office.
Okay.
And that's where my office resides. We also have centers, Center for Drugs, Center for Biologics, Center for Tobacco, Center for Veterinary Medicine. So those are centers. In the commissioner's office is the Office of External Affairs. It's the only forward-facing office where we actually interact with stakeholders. Now, down on the center level, they do have communication offices as well, but they are very specific to their particular center, whether it's a drug product or device product. But in the commissioner's office, we have the ability to interact with all stakeholders, not just looking at a specific disease entity. Now, in my office, we have two teams. We have a patient liaison team, and we have a health professional liaison team. I am on the patient liaison team, but actually, by being a director of a program, I interface and interact with both health professionals and patients. So, so in my office, I look at my office as an office. We're kind of like the FDA navigators. I look at us as GPS. If you contact my office or anybody on the staff with any question, we will be able to navigate the system and actually find the point of contact that you need in order to get the information that you're requesting. So in my office, we have a cancer liaison program. We have an HIV/AIDS program, which is how my office started back in the 80s when you had the protests talking about the FDA, you're not doing anything, people are dying. So my office was created out of patient advocacy.
Okay.
Yes. And so I mentioned a cancer liaison program. We have a patient network program, which my cardiovascular endocrine program falls under that. And so the cardiovascular endocrine program, its inception was back in 2011. We felt as though because of the obesity epidemic, because of the cardiovascular and diabetes epidemic, that we need to have staff focused on this. And so this is the newest program in my office. And I was given the privilege of developing this program.
Oh, wow.
And so through the years, we have decided that we wanted to have a program that was bi-directional.
Mm-hmm.
We just didn't want to send out information to people. We want to hear what the community is talking about. We want to take their concerns
mm-hmm.
into the proper entity within the agency and get them the answers that they need.
Mm-hmm.
So how do we do this? We attend meetings. Like you're a nurse, so we will go to your national Nurses Association.
Okay.
We do have an Office of Minority Health, and they do target going to conferences for minority. They target minority conferences.
Mm-hmm.
But in my office, we can go to any conference. So I may end up going to the National Medical Association or the Association of Black Cardiologists because they may want me to present or talk to them about my program.
Mm-hmm.
But basically, I go to the American Medical Association. We go to a lot of different conferences. We hold webinars. We have live chats that we have with the community. We go to patient advocacy organization meetings, the American Diabetes Association.
Mm-hmm.
I present at their conferences a lot, but we also collaborate with these patient advocacy organizations. And recently we had a workshop that was put on, co-sponsored by the FDA and an external stakeholder. So we do things like that. When phone calls come in with an issue, we contact the division and we see whether or not this problem has been addressed by the division. And if not, sometimes internal work groups are actually established because of the outside inquiry from a stakeholder.
Right.
So the stakeholder voice is very powerful. Another program I didn't mention as in our office is our adverse event reporting program. That's in my Office of Health and Constituent Affairs. And that program is called MedWatch. And I know a lot of people probably don't read the package inserts on their medication.
Right.
Well, the phone number and the web address for the FDA for the MedWatch program is on that.
Okay.
And so if you're taking a medication or utilizing any medical product as a consumer,
mm-hmm.
you can call or you can submit online a report and let us know and tell us how you were harmed
mm-hmm.
by this medical product. And I think that's huge.
Mm-hmm.
You may ask like, oh, it might go into a black box and how can that help? Well, it helps because numbers count. We
mm-hmm.
are data driven. We are science driven and
right.
we are a regulatory organization.
Mm-hmm.
So the more adverse events we get for a particular medical product,
mm-hmm.
the red flag will go up, we'll look at it,
mm-hmm.
and something will be done. And I know you've seen like on the news, recalls, or
we
recalled something or whatever.
Absolutely.
And hospitals and other entities have to report these adverse events. Consumers do not, it's voluntary.
Mm-hmm.
So just imagine if more consumers would report harms that were created by medical products, how many more things we could remove or focus on to keep Americans safe. So let's talk about another program in our office. Trying to think of other things that we do.
I think so for me in this conversation to hear that the focus is on both the patient or the consumer as well as healthcare gives a more holistic view as your agency is trying to work out and make these situations workable.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think number one, that's very critical and important.
Mm-hmm.
And I know I've heard you say that the consumer voice is an important voice to you, but why so? From your mission, from your philosophy and where you're coming from, why is it so important to hear from the consumer, especially with all these educated and, all of the people that you
mm-hmm.
have, staff in your office and everything? Why do you feel that that's such an important characteristic for or a value for your office?
Well, the consumer or patient perspective is a unique perspective because they're the end user. And I can speak from my clinical experience. I felt a lot of times that I could speak for my patient as their mm-hmm. health provider because I cared a lot about my patients. Mm-hmm. But what I have learned, until you are actually that patient,
right,
you cannot really speak for that patient. Mm-hmm. So for an example, we have opportunities for patients to participate. We have advisory committee meetings, and these meetings are when the centers are trying to make a decision, approval decision, and they just feel like they don't have enough information. Mm-hmm. So we have an open public session mm-hmm. where you know, patients, consumers, mm-hmm. providers, health professionals, they can stand up and they get 5 minutes and they can talk about why this is important to them. Mm-hmm. This is all recorded, just like the health professionals that are a part of the panel that are making these scientific decisions. We listen to those decisions. And a lot of times we also have a patient that sits on that advisory committee with a physician, and their vote counts just like the physician vote. Mm-hmm. Their voice, we have seen many times that will have some of the other people sitting on that panel question why they are thinking a certain way. So the patients they're very powerful. They can make a huge difference, but they have to be there. They have to be present. And I guess they need to know how to interact with us. And that's what our office does. If you contact my office, we will help you find the proper entity, but we will also help you as far as that conversation. We know how to talk the talk,
yes,
and enable you to get what you need.
Yeah.
So that's why our office is so vital, and we want to hear from the patients. We want to hear from the health professionals so that we can help mitigate any harms that are out there, and so that we can improve the policies that we're putting forward.
Yes.
I feel as though we can't do our job as an agency without the input of so many different people and other than just the scientists that we typically
right.
go to or
right.
we have that are hired by the FDA.
Right, it's sort of like looking at the whole problem one way
mm-hmm.
and it should be viewed two ways, not
That's
only
true.
The providers or from that perspective, but most certainly the end user, as you said. When I think about your office, cardiology, liaison, the endocrine program. If you could just describe your program in your office in, let's say, three words or so, what would you leave with the consumers to think about your office in that succinct manner?
I guess I would look at the communication tools that we use in
yes,
my office.
Yes.
We have e-newsletters, and I would love for everybody to subscribe to our patient network news. We have web pages. So you mentioned in your opening FDA.gov.
Right.
And I know going there trying to navigate may seem like an impossible task, yeah. but we have drop-down menus that have patients, consumers,
okay.
health professionals. And if you click on those, you definitely will get to my office under patient and health professionals. But under those tabs, you will find information. We have Federal Register notices, which basically decisions we need to make. And you can comment on the docket as Joe Consumer. You
okay.
don't have to be commenting as the American Nurses Association,
Black
expert. Nurses Association.
Okay.
You
okay.
So you can comment that way so your voice can be heard. Attend some of our workshops. So when you go to that FDA.gov, we have a list of meetings, workshops. So look at those things and see what's of interest to you and come to those meetings
mm-hmm.
and register for those meetings.
Right.
We look at those registrations and decide if we want to invite some of those people back for something else.
Mm-hmm.
We publish articles in different journals, but we would love to publish in more.
Mm-hmm.
So if you're affiliated with different organizations, let us know, because we would love to put that information out there. What we do, we need to get that information out. We have e-subscriber lists. The Cardiovascular and Endocrine Liaison Program, we have a CardioBeat e-subscriber list, and we have a Diabetes Monitor
mm-hmm.
e-subscriber list. And what happens when you subscribe to that? You get every FDA announcement on cardiovascular disease or diabetes, whichever
oh, wow.
one you sign up for,
wow.
whether it's a new approval, Right. Whether it's a guidance document, whether it's a recall,
right.
whether it's a safety alert.
Right.
Anything that comes out of our agency goes out on those listservs. So that's a way that they can get information. And then we also, I mentioned the open public sessions. We hold listening sessions with organizations. Mm-hmm. So if organizations contact the agency, we hold listening sessions when they have a particular issue.
Mm-hmm.
We do that. So they can initiate requests.
Okay.
So those are the types of things that you can do as a citizen.
Mm-hmm.
And don't forget the MedWatch adverse event reporting.
Yes.
Definitely the webpage just came up with a new form mm-hmm. that now collects demographic data,
okay.
so race and ethnicity, and we've never done that before.
Okay.
So there are a lot of tools that we have. I want you guys, I want your listeners, your viewers to utilize those tools.
Right, and I'm going to throw in another, thank you so much.
You're
I'm going to throw in another group, our faith-based organizations. I'm going to, church, the nurses group, and all of those other groups. So I'm going to throw that in as well.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Oh, you're welcome. You're welcome.
I thank you so much. And to my listeners and to my viewers, again, that's Dr. Helene Clayton Jeter. And I'd like to thank Dr. Clayton Jeter for joining me here today. The Cardiovascular and Endocrine Liaison Program serves as a liaison between the FDA and the cardiovascular and endocrine health professionals and patient communities. The program encourages and supports our active participation in forming FDA regulatory policies that promote healthy dietary and nutrition practices and advances the safety and effectiveness of human medical products that treat diabetes, hypertension, heart disease, and obesity. So discover how you or your organization can collaborate with the FDA by visiting the FDA site at www.fda.gov. If you'd like more information as well about the Department of Nursing and Allied Health at the University of the District of Columbia, visit our website at www.udc.edu/nursing. I'm Dr. Connie Webster. Thank you for watching. Please join me next time, and remember, your